Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to worship. Today is the second Sunday after Pentecost. It's a lovely, not hot summer morning out there. Just a few announcements for today. We are starting a new liturgy for summer, something that we've done over the past summer, so you should be able to participate easily. All of our hymns today are going to be out of the Bob book, so they won't be printed on the screen, so sing right out of the book. And our sending hymn is the insert in the bulletin. And one big announcement is that Wednesday is picnic in the park at 11:30, is that correct, Missy? There are needs for volunteers, donations. Any questions, you can contact Missy, Jackie, Abby Smith, and Amanda. We have two more dates in July and August where we will participate. It's at 11:30, so any questions, contact those names that I mentioned. We do need another representative for the fair stand, so contact Nick Ekman or Trent Johnson for that. Any other announcements? Oh, yes, 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 thank you. Thank you. I like that expression, a mock genuine, or genuine mock, or genuine artificial. Any other announcements? If you're able, please stand for our welcome to worship. Jesus said that whoever welcomes one of his followers welcomes Jesus himself. So turn to the person beside you and say, welcome to worship. Welcome to worship. Whoever welcomes Jesus also welcomes God, so turn to someone else and welcome them to worship. Welcome to worship. Welcome to worship. Whoever offers even a cup of cold water to one of God's children will be blessed by God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, let the silent mystery of your Spirit surround, sustain, and excite us. Transform our gathering to your glory and perfect our worship for your praise. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. One of our summertime traditions is to choose hymns. So going throughout the summer, our gathering hymn will be your choice. Maybe two, maybe three. So, whoever calls out the first one gets to start first. Stump the piano player, right, Laurel?
Bob 86.
Bob 86? Is that correct? I guess yes. Bob 86. by the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, oh, dwell in deepest sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make the darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my Lord to them, whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest wheat I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them, whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. Let's do one more. 728 in the ELW, 728. How many verses should we do, Laurel?
Three.
Okay. 1, 2, and 3? Sure.
Blessed are they, the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are they, full of sorrow, they shall be consoled. Rejoice and be glad. Blessed are you, holy are you. Rejoice and be glad. Yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are they, the lowly ones. yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are they who show mercy, mercy shall be theirs. Blessed are they the pure of heart, they shall see God. Rejoice and be glad. Blessed are you, holy are you.
Please stand if you're able for the confession and forgiveness. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are tired and worn out from carrying heavy burdens. Put down that heavy load you are carrying, and you will find rest for your souls." Let us confess our sins before God and before each other. Holy and loving God, we confess that we don't always understand our own actions. We clearly know what is right, what you expect of us, but we don't always do it. We also clearly know what is wrong, the thoughts and actions that hurt others and offend you, but we do these things anyway. Forgive us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, set us free from the sin that controls us. People of God, know this. Our God is merciful and compassionate, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. When we stumble, God is there to catch us. When we are weighed down, God is there to lift us up. So be at peace. Your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, you are the source of life and the ground of our being. By the power of your Spirit, bring healing to this wounded world and raise us to the new life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
Our first reading today is from the book of Hosea, a reading from Hosea. God said, "I'll go back to where I came from until they come to their senses. When they finally hit rock bottom, maybe they'll come looking for me." Israel said, "Come on, let us go back to God. He hurt us, but he'll heal us. He hit us hard, but he'll put us right again. In a couple of days, we'll feel better. By the third day, he'll have made us brand new, alive and on our feet, fit to face him. We're ready to study God, eager for God's knowledge, as sure as dawn breaks. So sure is his daily arrival. He comes as rain comes, as spring rain refreshing the ground." And God said, "What am I to do with you, Ephraim? What do I make of you, Judah? Your declarations of love last no longer than morning mist and pre-dawn dew. That's why I use prophets to shake you to attention, why my words cut you to the quick, to wake you up to my judgment, blazing like light. I'm after love that lasts not more than religion. I want you to know God, not go to more prayer meetings." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm of the day is Psalm 50. We'll read it responsively. Are you listening, dear people? I'm getting ready to speak. Israel, I'm about ready to bring you to trial. This is God, your God, speaking to you.
I don't find fault with your acts of worship, the frequent burnt sacrifices you offer.
But why should I want your blue ribbon bull? or more and more goats from your herds.
Every creature in the forest is mine, the wild animals on all the mountains. I know every mountain bird by name. The scampering field mice are my friends.
If I get hungry, do you think I'd tell you? All creation and its bounty are mine. Do you think I feast on venison or drink draughts of goat's blood?
Spread for me a banquet of praise, served by God, a feast of kept promises.
And call for help when you're in trouble.
I'll help you and you'll honor me.
Our second reading is from the book of Romans, a reading from Romans. That famous promise God gave Abraham that he and his children would possess the earth was not given because of something Abram did or would do. It was based on God's decision to put everything together for him, which Abram then entered when he believed. If those who get what God gives them only get it by doing everything they are told to do, or filling out all the right forms properly signed, that eliminates personal trust completely and turns the promise into ironclad contract. That's not a holy promise, that's a business deal. A contract drawn up by a hard-nosed lawyer and with plenty of fine print only makes sure that you will never be able to collect. But if there is no contract in the first place, simply a promise, and God's promise is that, at that, you can't break it. This is why the fulfillment of God's promise depends entirely on trusting God and his way, and then simply embracing him and what he does. God's promise arises as pure gift. That's the only way everyone can be sure to get in on it. Those who keep the religious traditions and those who have never heard of them. For Abraham is father of us all. He is not our racial father. That's reading the story backward. He is our faith father. We call Abraham father not because he got God's attention by living like a saint, but because God made something out of Abraham when he was a nobody. Isn't that what we've always read in Scripture? God saying to Abraham, I set you up as father of many peoples. Abraham was first named father and then became a father because he dared to trust God to do what only God could do, raise the dead to life, with a word make something out of nothing. When everything was hopeless, Abraham believed anything, deciding to live not on the basis of what he saw he couldn't do, but on what God said he would do. And so he was made father of a multitude of peoples. God himself said to him, you're going to have a big family, Abraham. Abraham didn't focus on his own impotence and say, it's hopeless. This 100-year-old body could never father a child. Nor did he survey Sarah's decades of infertility and give up. He didn't tiptoe around God's promise, making cautiously skeptical questions. He plunged into the promise and came up strong, ready for God, sure that God would make good on what he had said. That's why it is said Abraham was declared fit before God by trusting God to set him right. But it's not just Abraham, it's also us. The same thing gets said about us when we embrace and believe the one who brought Jesus to life when the conditions were equally hopeless. The sacrifice Jesus made us fit for God set us right with God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand if you're able. A reading from Matthew. Passing along, Jesus saw a man at his work collecting taxes. His name was Matthew. Jesus said, come along with me. Matthew stood up and followed him. Later, when Jesus was eating supper at Matthew's house with his close followers, a lot of disreputable characters came and joined them. When the Pharisees saw him keeping this kind of company, they had a fit and lit into Jesus' followers. "What kind of example is this from your teacher, acting cozy with crooks and misfits?" Jesus, overhearing, shot back, "Who needs a doctor, the healthy or the sick? Go figure out what this scripture means. I'm after mercy, not religion. I'm here to invite outsiders, not coddle insiders." As he finished saying this, a local official appeared, bowed politely, and said, "My daughter has just now died. If you come and touch her, she will live." Jesus got up and went with him, his disciples following along. Just then, a woman who had hemorrhaged for 12 years slipped in from behind and lightly touched his robe. She was thinking to herself, "If I can just put a finger on his robe, I will get well." Jesus turned and caught her at it. Then he reassured her, "Courage, daughter. You took a risk of faith, and now you are well." The woman was well from then on. By now they arrived at the house of the town official and pushed their way through the gossips looking for a story and the neighbors bringing in casseroles. Jesus was abrupt. "Clear out. This girl is not dead. She is sleeping." They told him he didn't know what he was talking about. But when Jesus had gotten rid of the crowd, he went in, took the girl's hand, and pulled her to her feet, alive. The news was soon out and traveled throughout the region. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I love how when I read scripture, a word or phrase jumps out at me, especially something that is current in my life or in the world around me, or even more when it's challenging and could strike up controversy. I had this happen with the last verse in our reading from Hosea. "I am after the love that lasts, not more religion. I want you to know God, not go to more prayer meetings." The Hebrew direct translation of this is, "I desire steadfast love, kindness, and mercy, not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God, and not burnt offerings." God is telling Israel through the prophet Hosea to go out and live God's love. A proper faith is not stuck in rituals where you bargain with God with sacrifices. In our current context, God wants us to live faithfully with love, respect, and compassion in a world that has gone crazy at times. Last week, I said this to the confirmands in my sermon and to you as well. Today is not about future church attendance. It's about living out what we say we believe. It's about living out the extravagant and unmerited love God gives us first. It's about living out God's justice, which defeated sin, death, and the power of evil when Christ rose from the tomb. Last weekend was the annual Nebraska Synod Assembly in Kearney, and it's worth every minute. I strongly urge you to go if you have never been. And the Synod's year-long focus is go and dot, dot, dot. At the end of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus gives the Great Commission where he tells his disciples and us to go. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. So what does Jesus command? Love. And to love in two ways. First, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. Now, the first of the three Ten Commandments are concerned with our relationship with God. Don't make anything more important than God. Don't misuse God's name. And take time off to rest and spend it with God. Now, second, Jesus reminds us to love our neighbors as ourselves. So the 4th through 10 commandments deal with interpersonal relationships with each other. Don't physically, mentally, or emotionally abuse others. Respect your partner and spouse. Don't steal or lie from others. Don't spend your energy on wanting someone else's partner, spouse, or possessions. The 10 commandments are guidelines for living in a harmonious and peaceful relationship with God and with each other. So go and love. Living in harmony is not meant to be a hobby or something to fit into a sports schedule or in our Sunday morning. Religion is not something we do as a pastime. Our faith needs to be taken seriously. It has everything to do with the meaning of life. Go and live out love. We have several examples of Jesus going out and living out love in our gospel reading today. Jesus calls out to Matthew, a sinfully and socially despised tax collector, and invites him to follow him. Matthew invites Jesus to join him and his guests for supper at his house. And the guests also have disreputable reputations like Matthew. The religious leaders, or morality squad, like I like to call them, they throw a fit. What kind of leader would eat with these undesirables? A leader of the local synagogue shows up and bows before this unorthodox teacher named Jesus, and he throws out protocol because he loves his daughter who just died. Come to my house and revive my daughter with your touch, he says. And on their way to his house, a woman who's bleeding made her unclean ventures out into the crowd following Jesus, the only one she knows can help. Jesus goes out and brings healing, physical healing, spiritual healing, emotional healing, social healing, relational healing, restorative healing. This is God working God's steadfast love through mercy and kindness. The love we are to focus on and live out. This is what pleases God. Not sacrifices or burnt offerings or rigid rituals. One can go through the motions of a ritual without really thinking about it. But love and compassion is not ritual bound. It is a response to who we are, beloved and forgiven children of God. So starting today, sisters and brothers in Christ, go and love. Go and heal. Go and restore. Go and make a difference. Amen.
Every soul.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, let us affirm our faith together.
We believe in one God, who is creator, maker of all we see and all we don't see, who is ruler of the universe, source of all creation. We believe in one God, who is Jesus Christ, God from God, light from light, true God and true human. He is one with the Creator, the Word made flesh, our Messiah, Savior of all creation. We believe in one God, who is Holy Spirit, breath of God moving among us, who is one with the Creator, one with the Christ, our Comforter and our Guide, Mentor of all creation. Amen. Pray, O God, for the church. Unite us with any on the margins, that the whole world recognizes that your mercy is greater than our human capacity to restrict it. We pray, O God, for creation. Tend forests and fields, and safeguard all cattle, birds, and wild animals. Preserve lakes, rivers, and oceans, and send rains to water the earth. Revive lands recovering from natural disasters. We pray, O God, for the nations. Awaken in our leaders compassion for people who have too often felt forgotten or neglected, and inspire policy solutions that promote equity and inclusion. Lord, listen to your children praying. Listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
We pray, O God, for all who are in need. Accompany anyone enduring chronic illness, any who suffer in secret, and those grieving a loved one's death. Send healing for all who plead for relief from sickness or pain, especially Vicki Achenbach,
Vicki,
Sue Achenbach,
Sue,
Jerry Achenbach,
Jerry,
Ruth Ann Grimm,
Ruth Ann,
Gene Schroeder,
Gene,
Ken Carlo,
Ken,
Patrick Kester,
Patrick,
David Greckel,
David,
Connie Ekman,
Connie,
Allie Baldwin,
Allie,
Austin Baldwin,
Austin,
Laura Gieselman,
Laura,
and Kevin Rose.
Kevin.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Give you thanks, Holy God, for the gift of life and for those celebrating birthdays this week. Stephanie Stukrath,
Stephanie,
Jonathan Grimm,
Jonathan,
and Trent Johnson.
Trent.
We also give you thanks, O God, for your disciple Barnabas and all the saints. Renew our faith that you can do what you have promised and raise us with all our beloved dead to new life. Lord, listen to your children praying.
Lord,
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Share a sign of peace with those around you. Luke the evangelist wrote of our risen Savior, who at the table with two of his disciples took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened. They recognized the risen Christ in the breaking of bread, in the company of all believers. In every time and beyond time, we come to this table to know the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome, all are welcome here. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, O God, for making us your beloved children. We give thanks to you, Christ, for welcoming us into your arms in spite of our sin. And we give thanks to you, Holy Spirit, for coming into this place and giving us faith, hope, and love.
All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome, all are welcome here.
On the night when the world turned its back on love, on the night of betrayal, Jesus the Christ, the carpenter, was with his friends who were fishers and workers of crafts of business. He took bread, gave thanks, and broke it in his hands, passed it around, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after they finished eating, he poured a cup of wine, gave thanks for it, and passed it around to all, saying, "Drink, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me."
All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome, all are welcome here.
Come, Holy Spirit, and bless this bread and this fruit of the vine. Bless all of us in this eating and drinking, that our eyes may be opened and we recognize the risen Christ in our midst, in each other, and in all for whom Christ died. And Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, forever and ever. Amen.
At the banquet of the Savior, all are welcome, all are welcome here.
Please be seated. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Friend and stranger, all are welcome. And may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you, preserve you, and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God, who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and till the end of the age. Amen.
Serve the Lord in love and peace. Thanks be to God.